much activity in terms of systematic taxonomy. It's overwhelmingly impressive. I think we have some very positive results, but we don't actually know what those are yet. I don't think anyone has any idea other than their twig. We're expecting about how this will go is I'll just say a few remarks, and then we'll start building the tally and see where things head. The previous world record is 2,518 species, and I'm hopeful. But I think this is the taxonomic expertise that we see here represents probably well north of 2,000 years of training. In terms of there's 180 scientists or more, and some of the taxonomic expertise you're seeing here, you would multiply that times 50 years of looking at the organisms that they're looking at. So it's a very difficult thing to repeat, and I couldn't be any more delighted. I do have a lot of people that I'd like to thank at the front end of this thing. We have, before I forget, I just want to start with Carolina, and maybe we can give her a round of applause. From at least 8 to 10 states, Connecticut out here from California, people from North Carolina. You are what we were able to build the whole event with. We built all of the educational pieces. We had educational pieces in 3 different schools. This is a premier structure here. Two Rivers was absolutely ideal for this kind of setup and this kind of activity. I love this room. There's tremendous light. Jill, the principal, is here to say a few things at some point, but we absolutely couldn't have done this, but it's because I had all of you that we were able to raise money from the Normandy Foundation, and it's because of you that we're able to add on these educational pieces, the media, and everything that happened along the way. So, there's a lot of people to thank. I can run through some of these quickly, and then Jill, come up and thank some others. And anybody else? So let's come up and say a thing or two about the many people and organizations and institutions that I forgot. Please do. So Leanne was the third piece of our trifecta. Leanne Hardy, where are you? So Leanne is around somewhere, but Leanne is the director of the Connecticut State Museum of Natural History. And so really it was the three of us that were responsible for much of what happened in terms of logistics and organization. But if anything's gone wrong, it's usually my fault. But in any case, I also want to thank our partners across the river. The Connecticut Science Center came in big near the end, and so their support, I think, raised the level of awareness. We've had lots of meetings. We've been on NPR, the Dorothy Johns, we're the number one listed event this morning. We're all things considered, where we live, pieces in the New York Times, in the Hartford Current, and so again, that's been awesome. So again, the school has been really, really giving in terms of staff time and infrastructure, but also contributed monetarily in many ways, providing the buses, much of the help in the cafeteria, computer, and the custodial services and what have you. So that's been huge, and they're also part of an umbrella organization, the National Region Education Council, and they've been really instrumental and very helpful. We love the fact that Connecticut DEP is a big partner in this, the Department of Energy and Environmental Protection. Their initial interest was what it could be given circumstances, but the Inland Fisheries Group and what they did for the parasitologists was absolutely fantastic in terms of providing fish. They kind of worked themselves into a hoo-ha, and it just kept growing, and it was really spectacular what they did in terms of electroshock fishing that came out twice. Another really important piece of all this, at least in terms of the infrastructure, is the Department of Ecology and Evolutionary Biology. So a lot of the biological expertise comes out of there. And I can't say enough about this wouldn't be possible, really, without not only the professors and the faculty, but also the grad students and the postdocs. And we have some repeat offenders that have come back from out of town to be a part of this event. So the UConn Microbial Analysis Center, Kendra, are you here? So she's given so much of herself and time, and actually did some outside fundraising from Illumina and MoMA. But there was a tremendous economic input into what we're trying to do. And we're really proud of all the species that we found over the course of 24 hours. I'm going to let Kendra talk later because I don't want to find lots of microbes. I can't tell you how many microbes. She probably can go home and sleep part of the time and collect more species than we can. But I also want to thank my College of Liberal Arts and Sciences, because our dean has been very supportive of this. And he's going to the red, and I think we've already gone into the red. He's offered to go to bat for us a little bit. There's been some very special things about this blitz, I think, that sets it apart from anything. This is the biggest assembly of taxonomic experts. I also should give a shout to amateurs, because there's a lot of people who are non-professional biologists that are damn good taxonomists and systematists, and some actually in this room published. I think the book that sold the most was written by Tom Murray. But we couldn't actually do this to the degree, to the level we did, without actually sort of people who are doing this avocationally. They love bird watching, they like collecting bees, or they are fabulous field botanists. And so it's not just about these professionally trained people. We did do it. There's tremendous amount of student training that goes on, just in terms of grads and undergrads, but we went clear down to middle schoolers here, and that's a piece that I really like. We always try to do something like that. We did this. We're the only BioBlitz in the country, I bet, that did something in this crappy habitat, in the sense that, you know, we have, I don't know what the imperial services are right here, but it's probably close to 50%. Most people are out going into a national park. They're going into a pristine area. If you have topography, you're going to get more species. You don't have topography. We did this, and this is not my idea. This is Ellen Sinsky, the previous director, who really built this model of wildlife. She wanted to bring a love and knowledge and appreciation for wildlife, the plant, and animal life to the city, to people that don't normally have a chance to get an appreciation for how wonderful New England is or how much biodiversity there is within a mile of your yard. So it's very special. We were challenged to do this in Hartford and in East Hartford, but you're going to be really blown away by how much wonderful, spectacular biodiversity. Anybody who spent any time looking through a microscope in the last 24 hours saw some amazing, there's a whole other world there, and it's a whole other universe underneath the microscope. And there's spectacular beauty and diversity and still a room for intellectual discovery. The caterpillar lab was awesome. I don't know if any of you got to do this, but we had the largest collection of live animals, at least invertebrates, in that auditorium that's ever been assembled in New England. I think that's special about our event. We had many authors. The exhibitors were amazing this time. All the live animals were great. The algologists have gone over the top. The parasitologists have gone over the top relative to past efforts. So that's deeply appreciated. Charles Darwin. The High National team is a new component to the group. Their High National has been a part of probably every one of the 200 biolabs. But there are new components for ours, at least at this level. I think last year we had a lot of folks on High National. I think we probably this year ramped up by an order of magnitude, I hope. And so we had a really great team. And actually, the High National people came from the farthest reaches to be a part of this. We really appreciate it. Do you know how many records approximately were? So they posted about 1,500 records. And what's different about theirs relative to what we did is that's part of the permanent, will be part of the permanent scientific record. And so So a lot of what we did will not actually be turned into vouchers and into collections that can go into a biological protection facility. If I had to guess, I would say that 500 vouchers will, or more, that will go on in terms of the contributing to scientific infrastructure and the permanent record. But these digital images with lots and lots of metadata attached are really important. I think I'm going to stop for a second and let Jill come up. Jill, are you here? Okay, if you could just say a little about the school. Jill is a principal of Two Rivers Middle School and actually allowed us to come and use her facilities.
Thank you. Thank you so much for coming. I have to say, some teachers came to visit today to see what was going on here, and they all said the same thing, that we wish this is what it looked like all the time, that if we could have our kids all the time doing this type of field research, using this type of equipment, and really understanding what it's all about, then it would be perfect. I think our custodial staff might feel differently. But, you know, this has been a wonderful thing for us to be part of. This is actually the second time that I was here. The first time was in 2005. I was not here for that. But Ed Smith, who was our field studies teacher, he brought it in 2005, and he did it again. So it's a wonderful opportunity for our school. Thank you so much for coming and making this a big one, because they told me it was going to be great, and it was not mine. So thank you.
Thank you. data. And I point out protists is not a single phylum. Yeah. And I want to say that our team actually included Tim Runke, a past alum of the University of Connecticut, of our department, who came up from West Virginia, Veronica Bueno, and Peyton Gallagher. And we were happy to have, a myriad pod expert, Joe DeSisto, joining us. So our numbers were beefed up, wonderfully, because we had that expertise this year. Highlights, and before I give you our total number, which our total number is like, when all was said and done, when we added Joe's numbers, we're almost double what we did for last BioBlitz. And then typical energy things like the beach and the survival record. Anyway, so here's some of the highlights. We got to dissect Indian colophon. That's the focal. Okay, that's awesome for us. And I'm supposed to say that the DEP fisheries guys, despite the fact that their number is low, really their number is high because their number contributed to our number. And Indian Calva actually had a proteocephalidian and potentially received record for Connecticut, but we also have to confirm that. But one of the other things we found was a non-parasite taxa. The reason I can say bryozoa is because we actually found statoblasts of a green bryozoan in one of the samples that was done in the Connecticut River, by our students working on the project. So that was really awesome. And in addition, we got really, really good monogenes of parasite infections this year. That doesn't sound good to me, but it's great for us. Okay, so in the end, our team did 160.
Just in case you forgot the number, 2,519 is the number of Wikipedia right now. Jill, no microphone, so you're going to have to shout out a little more.
Hey, I'm here to represent the mollusks, and we were looking at terrestrial mollusks and freshwater mollusks. And that means we were looking at gastropods, that's snails and slugs, as well as bivalves, which is river mussels and river clams. So, first thing I'll say is if we'd had a lot more rain this season, we would have found more terrestrial species. But we had two families of land slugs and three families of land snails. And in the freshwater, we did a little better. We had five families of freshwater snails and three families of freshwater bivalves. Now, the outstanding things for us were, personally, Jason and I, this was just two people doing this, Jason and I, our favorite was the pleuroceryd that lives in the Connecticut River, a very high spire water snail with a door that neither of us had seen the family before, so that was very exciting to us. But I have to give due credit to the Connecticut area because of the fantastic river mussels. And with a great deal of help from Laura, who was supposed to be doing beetles, but got carried away with the mussels. With Laura's help, we actually have six species of freshwater river mussel, one introduced Asian clam, and one hill clam. So that's a really outstanding freshwater bivalve for so our totals. Jason is a more conservative, he's more of a lumper, and I'm more of a splitter. So our total is somewhere between 24 on the conservative side and 27 on the more generous side.
So split that. We'll split it, we'll go on the down, we can afford to go on the downward side. So we'll go 25. Okay?
So working on bryophytes, which comprise three major groups of land plants, the liverworts, of which we found seven. We found 63 mosses, and then one hornwort, which is in the distant past the brother and sister of all vascular plants. And because the hornwort actually has endosymbiotic cyanobacteria, it counts as two. So, for the bryophytes, we have 74 conifer species. And if you're leading it, because I'm also reporting the lichens. So the lichens are a symbiotic association between fungi and cyanobacteria or green algae. And we discovered, there was a group of us collecting lichens, we counted 36 lichens forming fungi that had at least three different symbionts, so an additional 39 species.
About 90 seconds. We have a lot of
we had an amazing biogenesis for mammals. Every order was represented except for one, the cetaceans. So it was just absolutely fantastic. Highlights include four species of bats, big brown, silver hair, red, orange, which was absolutely fantastic. Rodents included a southern flying squirrel, strictly nocturnal species, which is always hard for us to do, and as well as a report of a meadow jumping mouse, really exciting. And in terms of the carnivores, learning some new things, that we found fissure in the limit of our circle. That's a really great species for us. Large home range, very challenging to find. And then we also learned that our recolonizing black bear population is made into Hartford. So black bears preserved in Hartford. We also include in the mammals a very important species, and that's humans, because without humans there wouldn't be a BioBlitz. So we include humans. We have 19 members and a total of 31 species.
Thank you.
just mentioned were the lesser group, which is pretty much all of the non-hyper-diverse orders of the insects, includes the odonates, the nameflies, the stemflies, all of these termites, all of these well-defined paths. And so we're a loosely defined group, basically scattered to the wind, just like we could, and a lot of people didn't bring us things that were really quite cool. One of the highlights of the dragonflies, there were two statements in species that were picked up, Gomphus paternus and Gomphus elastus, which is always good to find them. Total among all of the groups that we looked at,
Charlie Eisen, Julie White, and myself.
came up with 45 families of flies represented. The biggest ones were the crane flies. It's a group I studied, 42 species of crane flies. And thank you very much for those 40 light traps. That was very helpful for me. But also, a wonderful surprise was the work of Charlie and Julie with leaf miners. So we had 23 agaricidae, which are leaf mining, one group of leaf mining flies. And for out of the crane flies, three new state records for Connecticut, and a number of kind of the second record for species for the state. So that was surprising because there is a crane flies of Connecticut paper going back and forth. So what's the total? So the grand total for diptera, and I will say there's a whole segment of diptera that kind of what you would think of as the house flies and such. That group, we didn't really have great expertise, so that group was kind of untouched. But anyway, so the grand total is 183 species.
And it's a pretty diverse group. So the lepidoptera on the grand tree of life, there might be 200
150,000 species of butterflies and moths. You know, you guys are familiar with the diurnal things that fly around in the daytime, the butterflies, those are just diurnal moths. But after you go to bed, or you know, after you start having a drink or whatever at night, there's 19 species of moths that are taking over the sky after you guys tuck yourself in for the day. And so we have a very extraordinarily diverse drink, and I would like to report that our total is 442 species.
Thank you.
So these are the macroscopic organisms that enrich the biodiversity of Connecticut. In many senses, they our lives are enriched every day by this kind of biodiversity. In so many ways, they clean our water, they make our soils fertile. They provide the food we eat, the pollination service that we depend on. But you know, for many of us here, those economic components of biodiversity, while being essential, aren't necessarily why we're in it. We love it for the intellectual discovery. We believe our organisms, for the most part, are beautiful, and I know that many of you feel that way about them. So they're incredibly inseparably part of our life. And even in remote ways, they affect the tastes of our food. The colognes and perfumes we wear are often biologically based, our medicines and everything else. These are the metazoa that you can see here in Hartford, absolutely spectacular. What we don't really have an appreciation for and what we can't count with our microscopes are the bacteria that really run the world. And so, Heather Moss, maybe you can tell us a little bit about what you intended and what you found.
Okay.
So, Charles Darwin, we have to give a special round of applause. So this is actually Ken Knoll from the Department of Molecular and Cell Biology.
What I'm saying.
days out of your role. I thought that you said good things, and then we'll probably close our remarks for the day, and we can pack up and start heading out. This is, again, an amazing phenomenon, but Dave, can you come up and speak for a couple minutes?
Know that we can do something like this together. This is one for the record books.
Woo!